for starters, I asked your predecessor this, and I think the question is more valid now. Why do you want this job?
You know, Edie, I think each of us have certain skills and capabilities to bring to the world. And I feel blessed that my skills can be definitely put to good use here in California for PG&E at this time.
So what would you say then, if you just had to kind of sum it up, what you have that this company really needs right now?
I have a unique combination of experiences. I spent the first 15 years of my career in automotive, implementing quality systems and industrial engineering and lean operations, and then the last 15 years in the utility industry. When I assess what's happening here at PG&E, there's one thing I can see is really necessary, and that's the ability to put good processes, work practices, standards in place. When I think back to the automotive industry, putting quality in place was necessary for market competitiveness, for the company to compete and be successful. When I think about putting quality in place here at PG&E, it's a matter of life and death.
Absolutely. So what changes as you walk in the door?
We have really important ambitions. First and foremost, we are not operating this company for the bottom line. We're operating this company for the triple bottom line, serving people, the planet, and California's prosperity. It is not our objective to only serve our shareholders. In fact, my argument would be that very few companies can be successful with that mindset anymore, but definitely not a company like PG&E. Our job is to serve people, the planet, and California's prosperity.
As you assessed whether you wanted to step into this job, was there anything that gave you pause?
Well, I would suggest that when the opportunity arose, and my husband and I were talking about it, we could see that the demand was great. And when he saw the job description written by the board of directors, he read it and he looked at me and he said, "Did they write this for you?" And I said, "No, I don't think it was a custom job." He said, "I guess we're moving to California, because what is required is what I'm prepared to do and have been preparing all my life to do. And I feel compelled by the cause and to really make it right. Not just serve my time or do my best or help, I'm here to fix it."
You are, at least at this point now, we are stepping into wildfire season with this state in a drought. Does that scare you?
It certainly makes me think all the time. I woke up in the middle of the night last night thinking about inspections. That's a true story. But our business and our work is hazardous, there's no doubt. But when we follow our practices, when we do what we say we're going to do, when we follow our standards, we can keep people safe. And so it motivates me. It's on my mind all the time. But it motivates me to lead this team to do what we say that we are going to do every single day. And that is to both make it right and make it safe.
So I know that you've talked to your team about learning from the mistakes of the past, but at this point, really focusing on moving forward. But what would you say are the primary things that PG&E needs to learn from the recent history of trouble?
Yeah, you know, Edie, when I look back and I see the number of disasters that we have both caused and responded to, we've got to shift from the disaster response business to disaster prevention business. We have an opportunity to lead in process management. We have what we call our Clear Sky Playbook, and it's a simple lean operating model that is extraordinarily powerful in doing what we said we're going to do. And we are deploying that playbook to our wildfire mitigation plans this year, and then across the company through our regionalization that we've got underway.
The company's financial strength, I mean, you're coming in after some huge settlements, fines, the company emerging from bankruptcy. What would you want people to know about the company's financial situation at this point?
The negotiations that took the company through bankruptcy definitely have put the company back, but we have the potential to be very attractive for capital to invest in the system. But even our investors ask me the same thing. it comes back to the same issue. Are you prepared for wildfire season? So when it comes to our financial health, it does depend, again, on our same fundamentals of operating this company extraordinarily well. And then we will be able to be back in a stronger financial footing where we can invest in the system and make it safe every day. And so we're just working that process every single day.
One of the first things you did when you got to California was to go to San Bruno, to go to Paradise, to go to Napa and Sonoma. What did you think when you saw all that destruction?
It's unimaginable what the people have been through. I think about my coworkers and how strong they are in the face of recognition for what we have caused. And at first I felt sort of sorry that they had to bear that burden. But the more I've gotten to know them, the more impressed I am with their tenacity, their commitment to serve. We have a workforce that gets up every day and in the face of unimaginable pressure and challenges, gets up to serve their friends, their families, and their neighbors. And they are doing that with great resilience and great tenacity, and I'm very impressed by their strength, and that will carry us a long way in the coming years.
One of the questions that we hear a lot is this really gonna take 10 years before we're not having to shut the power off when it gets really windy?
Here's how I look at the whole spectrum. I think of it like a tree. We've got to work the problem from the branches to the trunk to the roots. The branches are the PSPS. That's like our last line of defense. It's the thing furthest out there that we have to use as our backstop. It will be our ambition to make our public safety power shutoffs less visible, less intrusive. What we saw in our Pollock Pines microgrid is an example of powering a downtown so that the vital services are available. You've got some other technologies that we can deploy in people's homes to continue to have them energized and safe. And so that's one piece. The second piece is that trunk, and that's making our system more fire resilient. Our standards have changed, and we are rebuilding the entire system in our high fire threat district areas. That will take some time. So we're going to continue doing the vegetation management using the best technologies to harden the system. But then the roots of that tree are the real root of the problem. And I'm a professional problem solver. The real root of the problem is the changing climate. The changing climate has to also be mitigated, not just adapted to, but thwarted. And we at PG&E are uniquely positioned to address the root of the challenge, the trunk of the challenge by hardening our system, and then the last backstop of safety for our customers is our PSPS, and we're gonna work to make it smarter and shorter. And we can do those three things simultaneously.
I would love to give you a chance to talk about the progress that you have made so far in reducing the impact of the PSPSs. When those started, they were much more massive than what we're seeing now.
Yeah, it's pretty impressive the degree of technology that we have deployed here. I'll tell you, in January, when I was first on the ground, I had an opportunity to participate in a PSPS event in January, which in and of itself was a disappointment that we were having a PSPS event in January. But what I saw was the technology deployed to understand the exact and pinpoint the exact factors that are driving the need and where we need to shut off the power. Fuel source, the wind speeds. We have professional scientists on staff who study weather and wind conditions. They're making sure it's safe. They're helping make sure that we know and can pinpoint exactly the factors that cause us to shut off that power. Shutting off power for people's safety is the hardest decision that we make. But we will make it to keep people safe.
But one of the things that we didn't see, and you talked about this a little bit, is this whole system now of weather stations, cameras. I mean, this is just an exploding technology. Drones.
We are using the top technologies. We are literally partnering with the best and brightest technologists around the world. And we definitely can leverage the intelligence of the people here and the technology that exists here in California. So we're putting the best of the science, the actual equipment on the system, whether it's the cameras, the drones, the LIDAR that reads where all of our trees are. And we can combine all of that data and run the analysis real time, in the moment, and understand where we need to protect people and make that tough decision to shut off the power, and how to effectively communicate with them. And I'm particularly excited about, as we go forward, the role that electric vehicles can play in powering homes during a PSPS event. And so I think we'll have more to share about that in the coming months.
Oh, cool. I have an EV question, but it's a different one. What would you want people to understand when they get frustrated about some of the, you know, we hear about, oh, well, this problem was caused by deferred maintenance or deferred. What would you want people to know about the entire system? I mean, you are running lines into very remote areas through very rugged terrain. How do you characterize the the extent of the work?
Yeah, the number of miles combined with the number of miles of our lines, both the transmission, the distribution lines, combined with the number of trees in those same areas. You know, one of the beautiful things about California is our trees. I love them too. And I actually have a photo I keep as my screensaver on my cell phone that is a little dirt road with a little bitty power line and 100-foot tall trees marked for removal because that power line is there. I think it's time to rethink that. And we need to do more with maybe not wireless power, but a lot less wires. Whether that's a localized microgrid like we're doing in Mariposa County, or undergrounding more. People say undergrounding's too expensive. I say, I'll tell you what's expensive. Wildfire's expensive.
Cybersecurity is something that the heads of many industries say keep them up at night right now. Do you feel like PG&E is fortified enough against that type of threat?
You know, I'm pretty impressed with our cyber team. It's obviously a first question I asked. Because I've been in this industry and I've been a CEO at a prior utility, I have a lot of experience in understanding the cyber risk. I have clearance at the federal level and have participated in national security calls for several years. So there are some real standards that you can test and validate and follow, and we are following and testing all of those. You can never be complacent, and it's not a question of when someone will try and hack you, it's knowing faster and shutting them off faster. And so I'm pretty impressed with our team, but we're always, always learning. And in the electric utility space, we do a lot of best practice sharing. Anytime we learn something, we learn it as an industry.
One of our local members of Congress, Jerry McNerney, has a bill that would get the Department of Energy more involved and have them kind of help utilities across the nation with this issue. Is that something you would need? Is that something you welcome?
We always welcome more partnerships and more engagement. Of course, generally, we work with the Department of Defense on this, but the Department of Energy is becoming more and more sophisticated. And we're, of course, excited to have Jennifer Granholm as our Secretary of Energy. I've crossed paths with her both in Michigan and then here in California. So excited about her leadership, and the Department of Energy can always be helpful in a lot of matters related to our business.
So quickly, climate change. Again, we could talk about this one thing for the half hour that we have, but you've called this a moral issue. What is PG&E's role?
PG&E has the opportunity of a lifetime and the obligation of a lifetime to make sure that we do everything in our power to enable the decarbonization of our energy system and the supporting industries that rely on our energy. Therefore, things like electric vehicles and electrification we're extremely supportive of, and actually will do a lot of good for our energy delivery system. I'm very proud of our track record. At PG&E, 85% of our energy, our bundled sales, is GHG free today. And so we obviously can continue, but that's better than almost any utility in the world. And so we're very committed to that, and there's more, though, that we can do to enable particularly the electrification of transportation, electrification of buildings. We'll look forward to doing more of that.
I wanted to super quickly ask you about the push to reduce the credits for solar customers, ask them to pay more so that they're contributing more to the overall system and grid. There are some people who say that is a disincentive for anyone to sign up for solar.
You know, one of the things that I always have to remind myself is that the electric grid is fully integrated. And so to add one source of power at a private residence or out in a community to build a power plant, the whole system is integrated. And so one of the things that we want to make sure is that we build the most optimized, lowest cost, decarbonized system. It doesn't necessarily mean to decarbonize equals high cost. And so when you do too much sub-optimized, individual, private locations that we're not optimizing and utilizing to their full efficiency, that actually is a big cost shift to people who aren't participating. And so all we're trying to do is make sure that our most vulnerable, for example, are not footing the bill for other people's power that is at a price, and we are required at this time to pay a price that's much higher than market. That's unfair, and it doesn't optimize the whole system. But there is a path where private solar will have a role. This isn't a zero-sum game. We can come together and find a way to the right combination of resources to best serve the citizens of California at the lowest carbon and the lowest cost.
You're a big fan of electric vehicles, I know. But there are people who are wondering, really, are we really going to demand more energy at a time when we could be facing rolling blackouts anytime there's a heat wave across the West?
Here's what's neat about electric vehicles. They can be powered, charged, any time of the night or day. The interesting thing about the grid is there is excess power. Even on the hottest summer day in California, it's in midday, we have extra power because we've got so much solar on the system. We could actually charge cars during the middle of the day and have them then serve in the evening as a resource. So electric vehicles can actually be net beneficial to the system and the energy usage, not an added usage. They can be charged at the right time and actually level supply with demand, which is something we haven't seen since air conditioning was first introduced.
So are you talking about a technology that's down the road, or this can happen now?
It can happen now. It's smart charging, and it's charging at the right time. What can happen down the road is actually utilizing what's called bidirectional charging for electric vehicles to actually power a home.
So that would be like storage.
It would be storage. Imagine having mobile storage. Imagine having an electric vehicle in your garage, and in the event of a PSPS, you just plug your car into the house and power the house. That's not too far away.
You've come here from Michigan, and the regulatory environment is quite different here. How would you characterize PG&E's relationship with the state? Because it was not very long ago that our governor was talking about a takeover of PG&E.
You know, we want what the governor wants. We want a safe and reliable, affordable, clean energy system. We need to re-earn the trust of our policymakers and our regulators that we will do what we said we will do. And I say that's on us. We've got a job to do to re-earn those relationships, and I'm confident that we will. That's why I'm here, to make it right. And we're going to do that. And in time, then they will find us a trusted resource for all of the goals that we have here in California.
And what do you say to those who believe that PG&E is really just too big and maybe should be gas and electric separately, or maybe should be state-run?
You know, I believe that an integrated, regulated utility can be a tremendous force for good and drive California's prosperity when run well. So we are regionalizing, because we want the best of both worlds. We can get the best of a big company. There's some real benefits of being a big company: access to capital, best practices, standards that we can set, talent that we can engage, partners that we can create. We can be a big force as a big company. However, we need to show up at our customers' front lawn as their hometown team. And so our regions that we are establishing across the state, five of them, will be designed to do exactly that, deliver for our hometowns. And instead of, I tell people, let's put our a big rule book on the back shelf and show up like a neighbor and do what needs to be done.
Well, speaking of customer service, when you guys first moved here, it sounds like you didn't have very good customer service. Talk me through what happened.
You know, my husband took the marker of signing up our new service with PG&E. It took a little while on the phone, longer than it should have. And then a couple weeks later, somebody came to the door and from the company and shared with us that we were getting a shutoff notice because we hadn't signed up for our gas service, which my husband thought he had done. Look, I'm not proud of that story, but it's an example of a process gone wrong. We don't have bad people, but we do have bad processes. And so this notion of this clear sky playbook, teaching this utility fundamentals, is very important to getting on the right track in all aspects of our business, including new customer hookup.
Another thing that I think is really changing as you walk in the door is this notion of leading with love. That's big for you. What does that mean for you?
You know, leading with love was born out of an experience I had. I made a decision as a CEO to raise the gay pride flag for the gay pride parade out in front of our headquarters, and got a lot of hate in response. I was surprised by that hate, but it made me realize how important it was to lead with love. And my sister, in fact, asked me, "Do you know what you're doing? Like, you're getting a lot of heat about this." I said, "Look, I'm going to lead with love." And leading with kindness, I think you can't go wrong. And frankly, for PG&E at this time, leading with love means making it right. We've done harm and we need to make it right. It means make it safe, both through a PSPS as a safety backstop, as well as hardening our system and undergrounding lines and making our system resilient to these changing climate conditions. It also means a little tough love, sharing stories like my new customer hookup that didn't go well, helping the team see we have gaps in how we deliver and we need to close those gaps. Our Clear Sky playbook will be able to do that. I say we leading with love both means leading with head and leading with heart. We've got skills, we've got capabilities, we need to deploy them, but we need to do it with some tenderness, some kindness, and a little love.
You would never have heard that from a CEO of PG&E 10 years ago. What's shifting?
You know, I think it's a recognition of how fundamental we are to the quality of life here in California. PG&E can be a great force for good. And I think the team that we have assembled, and I've invited the best and brightest from across the country to come and lead this utility, we know that we can make it right. But we do know it takes a little head and a little heart. So leading with love feels quite familiar for all of us.
I want to talk to you a little bit about your background. You're one of seven?
I'm the youngest of seven girls, seven daughters. I'm number seven.
How do you feel like that shaped you as a leader? Because it had to have.
I say there was two main things. My parents were wonderful people. My mother was a teacher and then a school principal, and so I tell a lot of people I learned to lead from my mother because she led with a lot of head and a lot of heart. She was tough, but she loved her team. But my dad was an engineer, and he taught me to be an engineer. So I had a little best of both, and I was my father's seventh daughter and his final attempt to get an engineer out of the bunch. And so he pulled out all the stops, and I'm an engineer because of him, and frankly, I think of it, he took a stand for my life, for my profession, for my potential, and it made all the difference because I was intimidated. I thought, that's not a career for girls. STEM isn't for girls. It seems boring, and he just kept, you know, encouraging me, and he made a big difference in my life, and therefore, we want to make that same difference for other people's lives as well and be a role model.
You want to talk me through quickly examples of where you're doing that?
Sure. One of the things that my husband and I are very committed to is an organization called First Robotics. And so every year I donate 50% of my annual salary to a fund dedicated to robotics and STEM access and education. It's a fund called Dream Makers. We've been doing it for several years. I basically donate my bonus to attracting young people to STEM education. My husband's a mentor on a high school robotics team. Both of my daughters became engineers because they were involved in the program. We've been involved in a number of ways at the national level and the local level. And we know that access to STEM changes lives. It changed mine. I'm a country girl. I grew up in a small town and have achieved career results beyond my wildest imaginations. And STEM was a big reason why.
What was it like becoming the CEO of the company your father had worked for as a nuclear engineer?
Yeah, that was wonderful. You know, it was the hometown company. And when I told my dad, he just looked at me. And I had to wait until the press release was like about to go because I knew he would tell everyone. And so I told him right before it hit the press. And his only response was, "Holy mackerel, So it was a big deal for us, and it was an honor and a privilege to do that. And I will say it prepared me to come out here to PG&E and treat PG&E like the family company that it is.
This is a pressure cooker job. I mean, it's been described by some people, as I've been doing my research, just as there are some days where you're feeling like you're kind of going into battle. How do you deal with that? What's your personal way of dealing with stress?
You know, I stay grounded in what is it that we're doing. And this, the ability to leverage technology like we are for the PSPS backdrop, that is our safety backbone. And so I know that, and then that gives me encouragement that we can improve everything that comes before it and make sure that the system is safe. And then I listen to really great music and I work out every day. And those two things are an important part of the process. But I really do stay grounded in our work, and I don't ever get distracted by worrying. But I channel my energy into working. And so we work it every single day. And we're getting better every day, I can tell you that.
And just last on the family, is there anything you'd want people to know about your twins?
Oh, I'm very proud of my girls. Margaret and Elizabeth are in their early careers, early 20s. One's in Detroit working for General Motors, a chip off the old block. Her dad still works at General Motors, so that's sweet. She's an engineer. She's brilliant. And my other daughter is also brilliant at doing technology consulting for a company in Chicago. Very proud of both of those girls.
So you mentioned compensation and that you donate a huge part of your salary to STEM. But as you know, this is an issue that can create a lot of anger for people, knowing that the CEO is making millions while their rates are going up. How do you explain to people the level of compensation at the highest levels of this company?
Yeah, you know, the CEO marketplace is a competitive marketplace for compensation. And so, you know, I'm being compensated about the same here as I was back in Michigan, maybe a little less. And for me, it's not about the compensation, though I do believe to whom much is given, much is expected. And I don't take that lightly, which is why my husband and I make that decision to give half of it away every year for the sake of others. Because again, we've had achievements and blessings beyond our wildest imaginations. And if I can use that to do good and make a difference in other people's lives, then that brings me joy.
And let's talk about why PG&E's rates are among the highest in the nation. And I, just so you know, we'll get to the sale of your headquarters next, because you're doing a lot to mitigate. But let's just start with why they are so expensive.
One reason why PG&E's rates are high is because our usage in many parts of the state is very low. And so the system has to be designed for a peak day and be designed and invested in for a peak day, but that peak isn't used very often. So it can inflate rates when you compare it to other states. What I like to pay attention to is what are our bills relative to other states and other users? And our bills are very competitive. And so I think that's sometimes confusing for people when we talk only about rates. Now, what I will tell you is great utilities, and PG&E will be a great utility, work very hard every day to lower and offset costs in order to fund investments. And some investments that we make actually reduce costs for customers. Every investment is not actually an increase in cost. We can trade band-aiding and expenses for a good capital investment that prevents the cost and can spread out the cost over longer time periods. We need to do a better job of that at PG&E, and we're gonna be working really hard to make sure we do.
So let's talk about some of the things that you are doing to prevent further rate increases. One is the sale of your San Francisco property, and that's hundreds of millions of dollars now that goes to back into the system.
Yeah, selling our headquarters in San Francisco will enable us to put about $400 million back into customers, reducing customers' bills by $400 million. We're very grateful for that. We're happy that the sale is proceeding. We did some other things like that. We sold access to our transmission towers to cellular companies. That was $900 million of benefit. But there's a lot of blocking and tackling that we can do every single day. And one of the things that I think I'm known for in this industry is exactly that. Finding the ways to eliminate the waste that is expensive in a system and make it more cost effective. And so we have a lot of opportunity here to really serve customers better at a lower cost.
I also wanted to ask you about culpability. I think one of the absolute low points for your predecessor was being in court and having to say guilty to 84 counts of involuntary manslaughter. And yet I think people from the outside felt like, but after all that, no one went to prison. Do you feel like there ever should be a case where someone actually spends time behind bars in a case like the campfire?
You know, I am absorbing California law, understanding all the implications. What I think is most important for us to stay focused on is preventing and ending catastrophic wildfire. My leadership team listened to all of that court proceeding. We watched all of the tape. We've studied the situation, and we have taken a stand that we will end catastrophic wildfire. And I think the state, our citizens, need us to do that. And so that's what I'm focused on.
If you're successful, when you're successful, how will you measure that?
We're going to measure it with our triple bottom line. Did we serve people? Did we serve our planet? And were we a force for prosperity for California? It's very measurable, and we will be measuring it, and we will know. And this leadership team and I are here until we're done. We're going to work on that. We're going to make our future bright. We are going to fix our system. We're going to make it right. We're going to make it safe. And we will know. And people will know us by the way that we love, and we're going to love through our actions.
Do you feel like you understand the depth of the anger in this region against this company?
I'm learning. I'm getting doses, of it. I can understand it. I can appreciate it. It shouldn't, people shouldn't fear the power that brings them life. And so it's on us to reestablish that trustworthiness. You know, we've defined our purpose that we're going to deliver for our hometowns, we're serving our planet, and we are leading with love. And I think it is through that purpose and galvanizing our 25,000 coworkers to do just that, that will reestablish that trust with the people that we are privileged to serve.
You know, it's interesting because I asked about anger and you talked about fear, and I think that fear is the heart of anger. Like, and so I guess the question really is, should people be afraid of this company?
I think the entire state of California has a new risk that is present, that we have to establish our expectations around safety and work together to make it safe. I have a saying, no one can do everything, but everyone can do something. PG&E cannot solve wildfire by ourselves. We have a big job to do, do not get me wrong, and we will do it. But we are going to be best served by working in partnership with the state, with CAL FIRE, with our local entities, making sure that we've done everything possible to mitigate fire. There's a page in the PG&E history book, and it talks about the 1906 earthquake in San Francisco. And one of the things that struck me when I was reading the history book was how everyone came together in recognition of this new hazard, earthquake, and had to redesign all the standards, the building codes, the utility had to set all new standards for how we laid pipe. Our pipe caused fires during that earthquake. We had to rebuild the whole system with a new risk in mind. I think California is best served when we all come together and we all do our part. And my ask for your viewers, Edie, is that they offer patience, a little grace, a little kindness to our crews, and together California can be safe again.
So my last question is really just, if you had to sum it up at the heart of it, what did you come here to do?
I came here to make it right. You know, there are great utilities all over the country. I ran one. I believe that California is leading the battle on climate change. both the symptoms of climate change and the ambition to thwart it, not just adapt, but stop it. And to come and be part of that is a full utilization of all of my experience. I am prepared for such a time as this, and I feel blessed to be the one able to lead us through this next chapter.